everyone, welcome to our channel Knowledge of Friends. Subscribe to our channel and click the bell icon for the latest update. आज हम लोग कंप्यूटर नेटवर्क की क्लास करने वाले हैं, जो कि क्लास आपका 11 है. ऑलरेडी हमने 10 क्लासेस कर लिया है. सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, इट्स अ ह्यूज रिक्वेस्ट फ्रॉम माय साइड टू ऑल द व्यूअर्स, प्लीज़ गो थ्रू विद द सब्सक्राइब बटन एंड प्लीज़ लाइक शेयर एंड सब्सक्राइब अवर चैनल, सो दैट मेनी एंड मैक्सिमम पीपल कैन गेट द इन्फॉर्मेशन एडवांस एंड इवन दो यू कैन ऑल्सो एन्जॉय द वीडियो एज वेल. वी हैड कम्प्लीटेड द यूनिट 1 टिल द लास्ट क्लासेस, दैट इज़ योर यूनिट 1 इंट्रोडक्शन टू कंप्यूटर नेटवर्क. In the second unit, we had completed your medium access sublayer. The unit third, we had completed about the network layer. And in the unit four, we had started with transport layer. And even though we had covered up many more topics in the last classes in the transport layer here. Now we'll start with the TCP, and we'll go ahead with a question here. In the same case related to the TCP, which is very important, and even though last class we had also completed many more things in reference towards the transport layer here. So first of all, it's a huge request from my side to all the viewers, please go through with the subscribe button and please like, share and subscribe our channel, so that many and maximum people can get the information at once, and even though you can also enjoy the videos as well. Let's go ahead with this. That is to the question is, draw the diagram of TCP header and explain the use of the first we have here, that is the source and destination port address. The second we have to, that is the sequence and acknowledgement number. The third we have is, that is code bits. The fourth we have here is your window size. The fifth we have to find it out, the origin pointer. And the next we have to find it out, describe the role of the checksum field and option pad as well. So that is your describe the role of checksum and checksum field and option pad bytes. This has been asked of 10 marks. So this is a long question where we have to find out many more things. So let's go ahead. The TCP headers, the TCP data is encapsulated in an IP datagram, and that is has been represented . This is your IP datagram. This is 20 bytes. TCP segment. And that is your comes under IP header, TCP header and TCP data. where that the format of the TCP header we will discuss here. The first has been divided into two. The second is the same. Third as well. And then we have a fourth that has been divided into many. Then we have the another one that is divided into two. And then after that we have then again we have and from here to this is your 20 bytes. And from this is your bits 0 to 31. This is your TCP header format. Now we'll go ahead with the detail. That it is source port number. That is your 16-bit. This is your destination port number, which is 16-bit. The another we have is your 32 bit sequence number. The another we have 32 bit acknowledgement number. And this is your header length. That is a 4-bit. This is your, that is your reserved 6-bit. This U, that is URG. Then this is your acknowledgement. Then this is your PSH. Then we have RST. This is synchronization SYN. Then this is FIN. And this is window size of 16-bit. This is your TCP checksum. 16-bit, and this is your urgent pointer 16-bit. This is your options, that is your optional, and this is data, that is optional. Okay, so this is a TCP header format that we have to represent it here. Now we'll go ahead with the detail. The description of the field in the TCP header. The first is your source port number. This is, it specifies the application sending the segment, and this is a different from the IP addresses, which specifies an internet addresses as well. talking about for the destination port, this it identifies the receiving application port number that is below 256 and are called well-known port and have assigned to a commonly used application. For example, port 23rd corresponds to the telnet function, port 53 for the DNS name server, and 21 that is assigned for the FTP here. With the same case, the sequence numbers, if I'm talking about, in the case of the sequence number that has been represented here, each byte in the stream, that is the TCP senders to the number, and that the sequence wraps back to the 0 to 0 till 2 to power 32 minus 1 here. The acknowledgement number that we have here, and here that the field identifies the sequence number of the next data, and that by the sender expects or to receive if the acknowledgement bit is set, and if the acknowledgement bit is not set, then the field has no effect here. The next we have is your, that is your header length, that is a 4-bit, as I told you about it, and it specifies the length of the TCP header in the 32-bit words, and because of the optional field, header length is used. And this is the reserved here, that is the field is reserved for the future use and must be set to 0 here. Where the TCP header contained the 6 flags that has been represented here. One or more than one can be turned on to the same time, and the functions of each flag is as follows. That the first we have is your URG, that is the urgent pointer is valid if it is set to 1. The second is your acknowledgement, and that same case, the acknowledgement that ACK bit is set to 1 to indicate that the acknowledgement number is valid. We have PSH, that the receiver should pass this data to the application as soon as possible. Then we have RST, that this flag is used to reset the connections. It is also used to reject an invalid segment as well. The another was is SYN, that is sync, and that is to synchronize sequence number to initiate a connection, and this connection request has a sync equals to 1 and acknowledgement equals to 0 to indicate that the piggyback acknowledgement field is not in use. The next is your FIN, F-I-N, that is the FIN bit is used to release a connection. It is specified that the sender is finishing the sending data. And the next is your window size here. In the window size, it specifies the number of bytes that the sender is willing to accept, and this field can be used to control the flow of the data and the congestions as well. The next we have here is your, that is in the terms of the checksum, and the checksum is used for the transport layer error detection here. The next we have your urgent pointer. In the urgent pointer here, that is it is the URG flag bit is set, and that the segment contain urgent data, meaning the receiving TCP entity that must be delivered to the higher layer immediately as well. With the same, next we have your options here, that is the size of the field is variable options field that may be used to provide the other function that are not covered by the header. The next we have your data, that is the data field size is variable and it contains the user data here. Where the TCP header normal size is 20 byte, which has been represented here. Unless the options are present and each TCP segment contain the source and the destination port number to identify the sending and receiving application, where the port number algorithm that along with the use and the destination IP addresses in the IP header, that is uniquely identify each connection, and the combination of an IP addresses and the port number is sometimes called a socket, where the sequence number is 32 byte and that is unsigned numbers, and the sequence number identifies the byte in the stream of the data from sending TCP to the receiving TCP, and that is the first byte of the data in the segment represent. When a new connection is being established, the synchronization flag is turned on and the sequence number of the first byte of the data sent by this host will be in the ISN plus 1, because the sync flag consumes the sequence number as well. Every byte that is exchanged in the number, the acknowledgement number contains the next sequence number, that is the sender of the acknowledgement that accept to receive, and therefore the sequence number plus 1 of the last successfully received byte of the data. This field valid only if the acknowledgement flag is on. where in the terms of where that the TCP provide the full duplex services, therefore each end of the connection must contain a sequence number of the data flowing in each directions, where in the same case that the TCP can be described as sliding window protocol without selecting or negative acknowledgement. In the same case, the header length, the TCP header length tell how many 32 bits are contained in the TCP header. This information is needed because that the options of the variable length will be a 4-bit field, and the TCP is a limit of 60 byte header. Without other option, the normal size we have is your 20 bytes here. In the same case, the TCP flow control is handled using a variable size, that is sliding window. This is the number of the bytes starting with the one specified by the acknowledgement number field that is received is to be linked to accept as well. Where in the same case that this is a 16-bit field emitting to the window, that is 65,535, and where bytes and the checksums that covers up here, and that is that covered up the TCP segments and the TCP header and the TCP data, that checksum field must be calculated and stored by the sender and then verified by the receiver as well. Where in the same case that the urgent pointer is valid only if the URG flag is set, and this pointer is the positive offset, and that must be added to a sequence number field of the segment to yield the sequence number of the last byte of the urgent data, and that option field is maximum segment size option, that can be the maximum segment size, that is MSS, and MSS is the largest chunk of data that TCP will send to the other end as well. With the same case, now we'll discuss about the compare the contrast TCP and RTP, and both are doing in the same thing that we had even though discussed in the last class, but I will just make you revise it out and we'll go ahead with further. And with the same case for the RTP and the TCP, the RTP has no flow control, where the TCP has a flow, and the RTP does not support error control, even though TCP support error control, and TCP has no acknowledgement and no mechanism to request the retransmission, and the TCP provides the acknowledgement and retransmission as well. And the RTP header has 32-bit header, and the TCP has 32-bit header. And the 16-bit sequence number it consists of RTP, and 32-bit sequence number consists by the TCP here. With the same real-time protocol, that is your RTP, used in the multimedia application, video conferencing, music on demand, music on video on demand, audio, video and text on the content of the multimedia, and where the RTP uses the user space and linked with the application program so that it looks like an application protocol. And RTP is a generic and application that is the that independent protocol, and RTP handles the real-time data streams onto a single streams of UDP packet, where the TCP provide a connection oriented reliable byte stream services. And that the term connection oriented means that the two application using the TCP must be established a TCP connection with each other before they can exchange here. In the same case that they had asked you about many times, that is the difference between the TCP and the UDP, where the TCP is a connection oriented and UDP is a connectionless. TCP connection is a byte stream, and UDP connection is a message stream, and the TCP does not support multicasting and broadcasting, and UDP support broadcasting, where the TCP provides the error control and flow control, and where the UDP it does not provide flow control and the error control. And the TCP supports full duplex retransmission, and that is UDP does not support full duplex transmission, and TCP is reliable, UDP is unreliable. TCP packet is called segment and UDP packet is called user datagram. Now we'll discuss the detail of what is TCP. The connection termination in the TCP is a symbolic, and where the connection establishment is or not, that we'll discuss, and why it is that has been asked of 10 marks here as well. Let's go ahead with that. First we'll discuss in the detail of the TCP, and then we'll discuss about it, that is connection termination in TCP is symmetric, whereas connection establishment is not. Why? That will discussed here. That has been asked of 10 marks. So where we have to discuss about the TCP connection, that is the termination in the TCP in the symmetric, and whereas the connection establishment is not, and why. So with this similar reference, this has been asked, as I told you, about 10 marks. So here in the transmission control protocol, that is the connection oriented protocol, and it is an internet protocol used in the transport layer, where the TCP provides a connection oriented reliable byte stream services. And the term connection oriented means that the two application using the TCP must establish a TCP connection with each other and before they can exchange the data as well. The TCP does not support multicasting and broadcasting. The application data is broken into what TCP considers and the best size chunks to send, and the unit of the information is passed by TCP to IP is called your segment, where the three segments that complete the connection establishment, this is often called the three-way handshake, and the four steps are required to close the connection in the both direction. Any of the two parties involved in exchanging the data that can close connection when the connection is on one direction is terminated, the other party can continue sending data in the other direction as well. In the respect towards it, that is that the four steps that are required to close the connection in the both direction, that is the four steps connection termination we have. This is client server. Here in the same case, where in this that process this is with respect to time, same for here it will go from client to server, and this comes from server to client. Then again we have that is from server to client, then again we have client to server. Okay, so here with the same reference towards it, that we have to go on ahead, and that we have when it goes from the client to server, then this is your segment 1, that is FIM, that is your sequence equals to 20 and acknowledgement equals to minus. And we're in the segment 2 when it's come from server to client. Where the sequence equals to 50. And acknowledgement equals to 21. In segment, that is FIN, sequence equals to 51 and acknowledgement equals to 21, where the segment equals to acknowledgement, that is we have sequence equals to 21 and acknowledgement equals to 52 here, that is from client to server here. This is the four steps connection termination. Four steps connection termination. In this, that the steps are as to be follows, that the client TCP sends to the first segment and a FIN segment. and the server TCP sends the second segment in an acknowledgement segment to confirm the receipt of the first segment from the client, where the server TCP can continue sending the data in the server client direction, and when it does not have any more data to send, it sends the third segment. Where the same the client TCP sent, or that is the fourth segment, that is your acknowledgement, and that is acknowledgement segment, and to confirm the receipt of the FN segment from the TCP server here. With the same regard of it, when we had gone through with that four steps, that is connection, that is the connection terminations has been done here. Let's go ahead with the question, and that what we have to discuss as well. The question is that the following is a dump of TCP header in a hexadecimal format, that is 0532017, and that for we have to find out what is the sequence number and then what is the destination port number, even though what is the acknowledgement number and or what is the window size, that what we have to cover up. So let's go ahead with that. So here we have a question. The following is the dump of a TCP header in hexadecimal format that we have 0532017. Then we have again here 0000000, and then again 0 and 1. Then we have 0000000 and 0 and 0. Then we have 50207FNF, and then again we have here is 0000000. And 0 and 0 here. This is the question. The first we have to find it out is the what is sequence number. So for that the solution we have here in the sequence number, the sequence number is 1, and here that is the sequence number, we can go ahead with 1, and each type each byte in the stream that TCP sends in number, the sequence number wraps back to 0 after 2 to the power 32 minus 1. So that is, and the second they had asked you about, that we will go ahead, and that is what is the destination port number. What is the destination port number? So in the destination port number, that the destination port number is 23, and it identifies the receiving application port number below 256, and that called well-known ports and assigned to the commonly used application. For example, port 23 correspond to the telnet function, and port 53 for the DNS name server, and port 21 assigned for the FTP. Let's go ahead with the third one that they had asked you about, and that is the question is what is the acknowledgement number. What is acknowledgement number here? That is the acknowledgement number here is 0, and that is this field identifies the sequence number of the next data by the sender accepts expects to receive if the acknowledgement bit is set, and if the acknowledgement bit is not set, the field has no effect. Let's go ahead with the another one, that is your fourth one, which is your the question is what is the window size. In the case of the window size is 2047, It specifies the number of bytes that the sender is willing to accept, and this file that it can be used to control the flow of the data and the congestions as well, which has been asked of 10 marks. Let's go ahead with the further, and that is your explain TCP congestions control algorithm in internet. So let's go ahead. TCP congestion control algorithm in internet. So in the TCP congestions control algorithm, that what we have to discuss here, that is in the same case, and that is your the TCP congestions control, when that has also been asked of 10 marks here. So that when the load offered to any network is more than that it can handle the congestion that builds up, when the congestion is established and the sender initialized that the congestion window to the size of the maximum segment, and that use of the connection, and when the connection window is n segment, if all n are acknowledged on the time, the congestion window is increased by the byte count corresponding to the n segment. It in effect each burst acknowledgement doubles the congestions window, and even though congestions window keeps growing exponentially until either of the timeout occurs on the receiver's window is reached. Where the internet congestions control algorithm uses the threshold parameter, which is initially 64 kb, in addition to the receiver and the congestion window, when a timeout occurs the threshold is set to half of the current congestions window, and the congestion window is reset to one maximum segment as well, where the slow start is then used to determine what the network can handle, except that exponential growth stops when the threshold hits, and from that point of view, on the successful transmission, that grow of the congestions window linearly instead of one per segment here, and that the internet congestions algorithm as well. So here we'll go ahead with the graph, and that will represent the internet congestions algorithm, and that we have. This is 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 22, 24, and here with this respect we'll go ahead with 4, 8, 12, 16, 20, 24, then we have 28, 32, then we have 36, 40 and 42 as well, that has been gone. So here the graph is corresponding towards this is threshold. Where in each segment that is pointing towards it. After the threshold, this is threshold. This is timeout. The graph has been represented with between transmission number and your congestions window. Here in the same case, this has been represented where these were the blocks and the examples of internet congestions algorithm, where the maximum segment size is 1024 bytes, and initially the congestions window was 64 kb, and but a timeout occurred so that the threshold is set to be 32 kb and the congestion window to 1 kb for the transmission 0 here, and the congestion window then grows exponentially until it hits the threshold 32 kb. Starting then it grows linearly. The transmission 13 is unlucky and a timeout occurs. The threshold is set to half or the current window and slow start is initiated all over again as well. And when the acknowledgements from the transmission 14 starts coming in, the first four each double the congestion window, but after that the growth becomes linear again. If no more timeouts occur, the congestion window will continue to grow up to the size of the receiver's window, and at that point it will stop growing and remaining constant window as long as there are no more timeouts and the receiver's window does not change size as well. In the same regard of it, that the congestions can occur when the multiple input streams arrives at the router and whose output capacity is less than that the sum of the input as well. And the congestions can also occur when the data arrives on the fast LAN and gets out of a slower WAN, that is your wide area network. The LAN is the local area network here. That the one typical example for the TCP congestions, if I am talking about, so that is that the senders and the bottlenecks, router R1 and then the router R2, that the then the receivers, so with then sender router 3 and then router 4 and then of course the receiver that has been setting up with the acknowledgement 3 4 5 1 2 3. These are the congestions caused by the fast LAN sending and a slow WAN here. The router R1 is labeled on the bottleneck because it is the congestion point router R1 that can receive the packets from the LAN on its left faster, and then that they can be sent on the WAN on its right as well. And when the router 2 puts on the receiver packets onto the LAN on its right, then they maintain the same spacing and they do not have on a WAN and its left, and even though the bandwidth of the LAN is higher, and slow start is the way to initiate the data flow across a connection, and the congestion avoidance is the way to deal with lost packet as well. Next, the question we had been arrived here is of 10 marks, that is explain the TCP segment header and discuss the TCP connection management, and as well as explain the TCP segment header and also discuss the congestion management. This has been asked of 4 times in the examination paper, so here of 10 marks, and that will discuss here. So here it is, that is TCP connection management. In the TCP connection management, that to establish a connection, TCP connection, the requesting end client sends a sync segment that is specifying the port number to the server that the client want to connect to, and the client initial sequence number. This is the segment 1, where the server responds with its own sync synchronization segment that is containing to the server initial sequence number, and the server also acknowledges the client synchronization by the acknowledging the client's ISN plus 1, and a synchronization comes one sequence number here, where the client must acknowledge the synchronization from the server of acknowledging the server's INS plus 1 as well. These 3 segments that complete the connection establishment, this is often called the 3-way handshake. We are in that same case, we can say here, that is the representation. Where it is segment 1, that go sync, and with segment 2. Again that sync and acknowledge, then from segment 3, that is acknowledge, and then of course from segment 4 it will fin, and from segment 5 it will acknowledge. Segment 6, it will fin. Segment 7, that it will go acknowledge. And this is server end and this is client end. This is the timeline of the connection establishment here, with the timeline of the connection establishment and the connection termination as well. And the side that sends the first synchronization is set to perform an active open, and the other side which receives the synchronization and send the next synchronization that performs a passive open. And when each end sends a synchronization to establish the connection, it chooses an initial sequence number for that connections as well, where the ISN should be changed over time so that the each connection has a different ISN. An ISN should be viewed as a 32-bit counter that increments by one for every 4 microseconds, and the purpose of in these sequences number is to prevent the packet that are delayed on the network here. In the terms of the TCP segment header, we had discussed about it, and we are moving ahead with a further one that is the question that they had asked you about. Explain the TCP congestion control algorithm in the internet, and what is the TCP segment header, and also discuss the TCP connection management that has also been asked of 10 marks and which we had discussed even though. Let's go ahead with the another one, and that we have discussed about it, the session layer design. In the session layer design, we had discussed issues related to that in the last class, that is relate. I will just tell you about in a short, that is you're managing the control, token management and synchronization. And the session layer that provides the following services, that is your dialog management, synchronization, and the activity management that we had discussed in the last class. So you can go on through with that in a detail. And now we'll go ahead with this, the data compression. In the data compression here, that they had asked you about to discuss different steps of JPG compression standard and the RPC and implemented issues, that what we have to discuss here. So first we'll discuss about it, that is JPEG, with JPEG compression standard. JPEG compression standard here, that what we have to discuss. We are that two main major steps in the JPEG coding involves, that is DCT, which is the full stands for the discrete cosine transformation. The second is the quantization. Third is the zigzag scan. The fourth is DPCM or DC component. The fifth is RLE or AC component. The sixth is entropy coding. And the second we will discuss here, that is RPC design and implementation issues with here, that is your, in the difference towards it, the first we have here is your protocol requirements. In the protocol requirements, the unique specification of a procedure to be called, with the provisions for the matching response message to the request message and the provision for the authenticating the caller to services and vice versa. The second we have is your communication handling. In the communication handling, if I'm talking about that, the RPC that can use any network protocol to deal the client and server. The connectionless protocol, that is example is your UDP, that is and then other than that, we have a connection oriented protocol, that is TCP, and create a new protocol that comes under in it. Let's go ahead with the another one, that is your the security. In security, that is the authentication, access control and the data production, that is the authentication that established whether the services requested are who they say and they are, and the access control that establishes the requester's right to perform some operations, and the data protection that guarantees the secrecy and integrity of the data exchange between the clients and the server. The D we have is here, that is call semantics. In the call semantics, that is the local call where exactly once, and the second is the remote calls, that is maybe and at least once retry request or at most once, so that retry request duplicates filtering and retransmit reply as well. let's go ahead with the detail, that is write a short note on that a digital audio, audio compressions and streaming audio. So let's go ahead, digital audio. In the digital audio, where that has been asked of 10 marks, and that is your, the sound is a wave phenomena like light, but it is microscopic and involves the molecules of air being compressed and expanded under the action of the some physical devices. Sound is a pressure wave, thus it takes a continuous values. We can detect sound by measuring the pressure level at the location and using a transducer to convert the pressure to the voltage level as well. The usual levels of the sound we hear around us that are described in the terms of the decibels, that is denoted by dB, and as the ratio to the that is a quietest sound we are capable of hearing as well. The sound wave is an analog. If we wish to use the digital version of sound wave, that we must form digitized representation of audio information, and digitization means that the conversion to the stream of numbers, and preferably these numbers should be integers for efficiency, that is for recording, that is need to convert the audio signals from analog to digital, that is ADAC here, and then for playback, that is need to convert the audio signals from digital to analog, that is DAC. Where the prior to sampling and analog to digital conversion, the audio signal is also usually filtered to remove the unwanted frequency, and the frequency kept depend on the application. Like for that we have your speech here. In the same case for the speech, that the typically from 50 hertz to 10 kilohertz is retained, and the other frequencies are blocked by the use of the band pass filter, and the screen that screens out lower and a higher frequency, as audio music signal will typically contain from about 20 hertz up to 20 kilohertz as well. The first step is working with the digital audio is sampling, and the sampling consists of taking measurements of the input and the signals at regular times, that converting them into the appropriate scale and storing them. The following is your 1046 hertz sine wave being sampled at 8 kilohertz, and the black dots represent the samples as well. With the same case, that will go ahead with the diagram, that is your amplitude and versus sample rate 8 kilohertz. So that will move in the frequency here, that will is in the form of, and where it is a move that has been the representation of zero, and where it is representing here that the scale we have from minus one, that is here it is zero, and that is your 15. Till the 15 it will be move on, and that will go ahead, and these were the dots that has been occurring here. So these for the sample, this is a sine wave of being sampled at 8 kilohertz here, where the sampling means the measuring the quantity that are interested in, usually the evenly spaced interval as well. And with the same case that the first kind of the sampling using measurements only at an evenly spaced time intervals is simply called the sampling, where the ratio at which it is performed is called the sampling frequency. And for the audio, typically sampling rates are from 8 kilohertz, that is 8000 sample per second, to the 48 kilohertz. This range is determined by the Nyquist theorem, and sampling is sampling in the amplitude or voltage dimensions is called quantization as well. Where the first step of digitization is done with the analog to digital converter, and the analog to digital converter takes a given voltage and a scale as to be appropriate digital measurement, and the stored sample point then represent a series of voltage that were measured at the input of the ADC, and sound has been digitized, and it can be stored or via that is your computer using any number of technologies, that is sample voltage has been initialized here. In the same case, I will go ahead with the audio compression. But before that, we will have to discuss the streaming audio as well. So let's go ahead with the streaming audio. Streaming audio, and as well as we have to discuss audio compression. In the audio compression, if I'm talking about here, that in that audio compression may refer to a type of lossy or a lossless compression in which the amount of the data is recorded, waveform is reduced to different extent for the transmission respectively, with or without some loss of the quality, and used in the CD or MP3 encoding internet radio as well. And we are with the same, the data compression in the representation of an information source, that is example of data file, speech signal, an image or a video signal, and accurately at the same possible using the fewest number of bits as well. That is compressed data that can only be understood if the decoding method is known by the receiver. And the data compression technique are broadly classified into the lossless and the lossy. The audio compression technique, we have the sampling frequency is 44.1, the quantization bit is 16, the format is PCM, and of course the quality is hi-fi music, and the CD quality is the CDCA. If the sampling frequency is 37.8 kHz, the quantization bit is 8, and of course the format is ADPCM, and then the quality is hi-fi music, and the CD quality is the CD1 level. If the sampling frequency kilohertz is 37.8 and the quantization bit is 8, and then format is ADPCM, and quality is FM broadcast, and that is the music, and CD quality is CD1 and a B. Then if the sampling frequency kilohertz, it is in kilohertz in 18.9, the quantization bit is 4 and the format is ADPCM, and the quality is AM broadcast, that is speech, and the C quality is CD1 level. If the sampling frequency in the kilohertz is 8 and quantization bit is also 8, the format is PCM, the quality is telephone, and the CD is not available. So CD quality is not available. So that is what we have to discuss in reference towards the audio compression. Now we'll go ahead with the streaming audio here. In the streaming audio, that is the continuous and uninterrupted downloading of the audio signal from the server, it's the streaming of audio. And a one way of audio transmission over the data network that is widely used to listen to the audio clips and the video from the internet on the computer, the tablets, and of course the smartphones. In addition, the computers are commonly set up to stream and a user music, that is the collection to the digital media hub that is connected to the studio and the home theater, and the computers that and mobile devices may also stream directly to the powered speakers via the Bluetooth or a Wi-Fi. And that unlike music files that are downloaded and played at any time, in which the future a stream song is played immediately after a small amount of audio and that is received, and song file is not stored permanently in the destination device as well. With the same case, then an audio stream is a continuous transmission to the listeners over the network, that is typically the internet, that consists of one or more program that is present sequentially, and it's analogous to the radio station that is over the air broadcasting, and the streamer is the content provider of string, and the streamer services to the customers as well. In the same case, the normalization is the method of regulating the loudness to be more consistent for the listeners. And network file playback is on demand of download of the complete program from the network, such as that is a podcast and the document, and the terms that stream and streaming take into the account, that is the network of file playback as well. Now we'll go ahead with the another one, and that what we have to discuss in the terms of it. And that is your cryptography and a public key crypto system here. In the term of cryptography here, that the original intelligence message that is referred to as a plain text in converted the random nonsense here that is referred to as the cipher text, and the science and the art of the manipulating the message to make them secure is called cryptography. And an original message to be transformed is called the plain text, and resulting message after the transformation is called the cipher text. The process of converting the plain text into the cipher text is called encryption, and the reverse process is called decryption. The encryption process consists of an algorithm and a key, and the key controlled by the algorithm here. And that is the key controls the algorithm, where the objective is to design an encryption technique so that it would be very difficult or impossible for an unauthorized party to understand the contents of the ciphertext, and a user that can recover the original message only by decrypting the ciphertext using the secret key. And depending upon the secret key used, the algorithm will produce a different output. If the secret key changes, the output of the algorithm also changes. That is the reason that why this is used here. That is known as comes under the cryptology here. Now we'll discuss the another one in the terms of it, that is the comparison between the public key and a private key, which is very important, and that is the symmetric key or a cryptographic key is as well. Difference between symmetric key, cryptography, and private key algorithm. Let's go ahead to discuss here. So here we'll discuss about symmetric cryptography and a private key cryptography, that is asymmetric key cryptography. So the difference, first difference we have for this, that is the same key is used for the encryption and decryption. And here the one key, you know, that for the encryption and the other key for the decryption here. The next difference is that it is very fast and it is very slow. And the key exchange is big problem, and key exchange is not a problem. And here that also called a secret key encryption, and is it called also key a public key encryption here. The next difference we have is your that the key must be kept secret here, and one of the two key must be kept secret here, and the senders in that the senders and the receiver must share the algorithm and the key, and here that the sender and the receiver must each have one of the matched pairs of key, and here in this that the size of the resulting encrypted text is usually same as or less than that of the original clear text size, and where here is the size of the resulting encrypted text is more than the original clear text size as well, and here that is that cannot be used for digital signature and that can used for the digital signature. So here we'll end up with this, and the next coming class we'll discuss moreover regarding towards it. And first of all, it's a huge request from my side to all of you, please go through with the subscribe button. And please like, share and subscribe our channel so that many and maximum people can get the information at once. And even though you can also enjoy the video as well, as we had completed unit 1, that is in that we had completed the introduction concept, goals and applications of network, network structures and architecture, the OSI reference model, the service network topology design, delay analysis, backbone design, local access network design, physical layer transmission media, switching method, ISDN terminals handling, that we had discussed about it. In unit 2, the medium access sublayer, medium access sublayer, the channel allocations, LAN protocol, Aloha protocol, overview of IEEE standard, FDDI, data link layer, elementary data link protocol, sliding window and protocol, that is error handling. In the unit 3, we had covered up the network layer, that is the network layer, point-to-point network, routing congestions control, internet working, TCP IP, IP packet, IP address and IPv6. In unit 4, which we had started in the transport layer, that is the transport layer, design issues, connections management, session layer, design issues, remote procedure call, and presentation layer, design issues, data compression technique, cryptography, that we had doing here. Then TCP window management will end up with this unit, the transport layer. Let's go ahead with the another one, that is your unit 5th. Then we'll go ahead with application layer, That is your application layer, file transfer, access and management, electronic mail, virtual terminals, other application examples like network, internet and a public network. That what we have to cover up in the next unit 5 here. So first of all, it's a huge request from my side to all the viewers. Please go through with the subscribe button and please like, share and subscribe our channel so that many and maximum people can get the information at once. And even though you can also enjoy the video as well, and you will get all the related information regarding all the videos, you can go through with the playlist. Please like, share and subscribe to our channel. Thank you, and thanks for supporting us. Thanks to all the subscribers here.